Hey guys, so today I'm going to be tackling a topic I get lots of questions about on my Instagram account, through direct message, through my email, on my website. Dr. Bowe, what do you think about dry brushing? Is dry brushing good for me? What are the actual benefits of dry brushing? So that's what today's video is all about. So for those of you who don't know me, I am Dr. Whitney Bowe. I'm a board certified dermatologist in New York. I'm the author of the best-selling book, The Beauty of Dirty Skin. It's been translated into over 7 languages now. And a lot of the research that went into that book actually has direct implications for my opinion on dry brushing. So let's talk dry brushing. So hey guys, I was just about to post this video and then realized that in certain shots, you can't really see my clothes. It's because my hair is covering the straps of my tank top, and I just wanted to, sort of let you know before you start watching the video, yes, I'm fully dressed, in case that was a concern. I hope you enjoy. So dry brushing is a major trend. Proponents of dry brushing claim that it helps with cellulite, it helps flush toxins from the body, it helps promote circulation and lymphatic drainage, it helps to even out skin tone, and it's a great way to exfoliate the skin. Now with Clarisonic going out of business, with the recent focus on the microbiome, there have been some people who are pointing out that maybe dry brushing isn't so healthy for the skin. So we will be examining whether any of those proposed and proclaimed benefits are real. So as an evidence-based doctor, I genuinely like to dive right in and look at the data. In this case, unfortunately, there is a paucity of literature, of peer-reviewed scientific studies actually examining the effects that dry brushing has on the skin or has on the body. So in this case, I am forced to think about what I know, my knowledge base about how the skin works, how it functions, how it responds to certain stressors, and also rely on my clinical experience treating thousands of patients, you know, over time, over the years. So let's dive in. I'll give you my take on dry brushing from my knowledge of the skin, how it works, and my clinical experience. So when you scratch the skin frequently, that friction creates mechanical force against the surface of the skin, and the way that the skin responds is the epidermal layer, which is sort of the middle layer. You have the dead layer on top called the stratum corneum, the epidermis, and then the dermal layer underneath. So the epidermal layer responds to this sort of scratching motion by getting thicker. It's a process called lichenification. So, you know, I have heard some people talk about how natural bristles that are softer are the ones that you really should be using when you're dry brushing. Yes, I agree that a softer bristle is less likely to create as much trauma. But even with a gentle, soft bristle, I do think that there is trauma that is being inflicted onto the skin. And I do think that over time, the epidermis will start to thicken and that process of lichenification will occur. So I'm going to give you some examples of sort of scratching and things that we see in the office that are sort of more extreme, just to give you a sense of sort of what this process is doing and how the skin responds to it. I realize that these scenarios are more extreme and, you know, it's not a direct analogy to dry brushing. And there are probably people out there who swear, you know, to the benefits of dry brushing, have been using it forever and are not seeing thickening in the skin. But just based on what I understand about the pathophysiology of the skin, even a little gentle amount of scratching over time is likely to cause some problems. So let's go there. So first, you may have a grandparent, an uncle who uses a back scratcher. So take a look at the skin of the upper back of that person in your family, and you will notice that skin is thicker. It's actually something, a technical term for it is called amyloidosis. That sort of scratching effect on the back leads to the deposit of certain materials that ends up thickening the skin. Another condition that we see frequently in the office is something called LSC or lichen simplex chronicus. This usually happens around the ankle area. There's an area that just becomes intensely itchy. People start to scratch it and then the skin thickens and then it develops into the sort of what we call an itch scratch cycle, where the more you scratch, the more it itches, the more it itches, the more you scratch. And over time you will develop this patch of lichenified or thickened tissue and skin in that area, usually around the ankle. Again, that's called LSC or lichen simplex chronicus. So now along those same lines, if you actually look at either one of those conditions, you know, the back scratch on the upper back or the patch of LSC or lichen simplex chronicus around the ankle, when you have that sort of chronic scratching that leads to the thickening of the skin, there's also something you'll notice about that skin. That skin is darker. It's called hyperpigmentation. So this is especially true in people with skin of color who have more reactive melanocytes. Melanocytes are pigment producing cells. They're the cells that pump out pigment. And what happens is that when you stimulate those cells with scratching, especially sort of over time or done on a regular basis, those cells will basically recognize that input as a form of trauma, and it will try to protect itself by pumping out more pigment. And so that leads to staining or darkening of the skin. So theoretically, in people who have skin of color who are dry brushing, they may notice that their skin tone in the area where they're brushing is actually getting darker over time. So another thing that dry brushing can do is it can actually make the skin more itchy over time. So I'll walk you through how that works. But I think I told you guys before about that sort of itch scratch cycle in that condition called LSC or lichen simplex chronicus. So when you scratch, what happens is that it actually causes certain cells in your skin called mast cells to release a substance known as histamine. Now, when histamine is released into your skin, it causes your blood vessels to dilate. So it causes something called vasodilation. And when that happens, there is increased blood flow to the area and you get swelling and the area can actually become more itchy. So the classic example of this is if you've ever had a bug bite and it's sort of like a little bug bite and then you scratch it and it just blows up, right? It can sometimes make things worse when you scratch it. And that's an example of histamine at work. So you've probably heard a lot of moms saying, stop scratching, stop scratching. That's easier said than done, because once the histamine is working, the skin becomes more itchy. And over time, if you sort of condition your skin, you know, if you're dry brushing it regularly over time, you're sort of consistently releasing histamine. You're consistently waking up mast cells and basically stimulating them to degranulate and release more of that histamine into your skin. And the other thing that can make mast cells degranulate is heat. So if you are dry brushing and you hop into a hot shower, chances are that your mast cells are not going to be very happy. Okay, so on a more happy note, dry brushing does boost circulation. So that's one of the things that people who love dry brushing, you know, will speak to, and they'll say, well, it encourages circulation. So it is true, it does encourage circulation. In my opinion, there are a lot of safer ways to promote and stimulate circulation. For example, if you're wearing exercise pants and you use a foam roller, or if you get a massage, or if you exercise, you know, those are great ways of stimulating and boosting circulation without also stimulating the release of histamine. So when you think about dry brushing and that sort of swelling or plump effect that you're getting, as a result, yes, you're getting boosted circulation, but you're also getting the release of histamine along with that, and inflammatory cytokines and little cellular signals that are stimulating inflammation, excuse me, along with that circulation. So yeah, I mean, it's not incorrect that dry brushing stimulates and boosts circulation, but it's not the kind of circulation that a doctor would recommend. So another thing that dry brushing is doing is it's potentially disrupting your microbiome. So for those of you who follow me on social media or who have read my book, you know that I talk about the gut-brain-skin connection and I talk all about the microbiome and the trillions of microscopic organisms that live on the surface of our skin and that are absolutely integral to the health of our skin and our skin barrier. And if we're dry brushing, what we're doing is we're actually damaging and disrupting the terrain on which those microbes live and thrive. And so consequently, we can be shifting and altering the balance of microbial species on the surface of the skin in a way that is potentially destructive and can lead to inflammation. So if you care about your skin's microbiome, moisturizing is amazing, but dry brushing is not. Okay, and then two of the other claims surrounding dry brushing. One, that it detoxifies the body. So your kidney and your livers detoxify the body. Dry brushing is not going to encourage the release of toxins through your skin. That is a myth. Another claim, I think the last one would be that it encourages lymphatic drainage. So when you think about people who have compromised lymphatic drainage, the appropriate medical treatment for that is going to be exercise, massage, and compression, not scratching the surface. In fact, people who have compromised lymphatic drainage have very fragile skin. There was never a doctor that I have ever met who would recommend using a tool to rub against that skin. In summary, dry brushing probably isn't all that it's cracked up to be. If you are a fan of dry brushing and you really genuinely love it, then I would say go with the softest bristles possible and limit your dry brushing to no more than twice a week. But if you're one of those people who's a little skeptical, not really sure if it's helping or hurting, then maybe this video has convinced you to spend your money and your time engaging in other forms of self-care. So anyway, if you found this video helpful, give it a thumbs up, share it with some friends. If you have other questions about dry brushing or about any topic that you'd like to hear me cover, please comment below or direct message me on my Instagram account at Dr. Whitney Bowe. I'm always listening. All right, guys, until next time, stay safe, stay healthy, and take the time to nourish and nurture your beautiful skin.